The roar of the thrusters cuts out, replaced by the cold mechanical voice of the ship's automated systems and the sharp beeping of an alarm. You strain against your harness, heart pounding, desperate for a glimpse of your destination. All around you, your colleagues close their eyes, silently hoping for a safe landing. The craft bucks and rattles, battered by the thin, unrelenting atmosphere. The descent has begun. The ship enters a controlled fall, dropping toward the rugged alien landscape below. Then you see it, the red planet. It's been a long time coming. After 6 months in the endless void of space, the moment is finally here, and you and your crew are about to reach your final destination, somewhere no human has ever set foot before, the surface of Mars. Now you just have to hope you survive the experience. How did you get here? Find out this and more on this episode of the Infographics Show, what the journey to Mars will be like day by day. Day 1, launch day. The journey begins today, but really it's been going for a very long time. The world's richest man didn't just decide to shove 100 people into a spaceship to Mars and wish them the best. It's been a massive multi-year recruitment process, one that has carefully selected an elite team of rocket scientists, engineers, botanists, and experienced astronauts. Together, they're about to attempt what was once thought impossible, the first manned mission to Mars. You'd better get a good look at Earth, because you won't be back for a long time. SpaceX has been working on its massive Starship space shuttle for more than a decade, and the largest space shuttle ever created has a lot going for it. Not only is it equipped to host a large group of people for an extended voyage, but it's designed to speed up the travel process quite a bit. Originally, a one-way journey to Mars was supposed to take up to 9 months, but that time has been shortened to around 6 months. A still pretty significant haul that'll take you away from the Earth for over a year in total. Because you're planning to come back, at least you hope to. Originally, Elon Musk was a major proponent of the Mars to Stay initiative, a bold plan to send the first wave of astronauts not just to explore, but to stay. The idea was to establish a permanent Martian colony, with pioneers living and working inside a self-sustaining biosphere designed to support human life indefinitely. You don't know if you would have signed up for that, but fortunately, you didn't have to make that call. The Martian project is at an earlier stage, and that means your team is mostly being used to prove that it's possible at all. You're going to be heading to Mars, spending enough time there to set up some essential infrastructure, and then return to Earth. But that doesn't mean everyone isn't still interested in your mission. After all, you're going where no one has gone before. And before launch day gets here, you gotta tackle one more barrier. The massive media throng trying to make their way to the Kennedy Space Center. You and your team of astronauts are some of the most famous people in the world right now, and you each have your own story. You're not one of the biggest names, you're a botany specialist who's going to be taking on the difficult task of planting the first Martian garden. You're not used to this many cameras in your face. They want to know everything, including how you feel about being one of the first people headed to a foreign planet. Somehow, scared out of my mind isn't the answer they're looking for, but it's all led up to this. You've been under consideration for well over a year now. You've trained for months, you've spent weeks getting to know your team, and now you're strapped securely into one of the many non-pilot seats on the spaceship, and you feel the rush of the massive energy surge as the rocket ignites and starts to rise from its launch pad. Soon, the bright Florida sky starts to fade and turn to a starlit sky as you sail into the atmosphere and past it, beginning what's sure to be an epic journey to the red planet. Hell of a first day! Day 2. Getting to know you. The launch is over, and the ship is firmly in orbit. Now you can get out of that seat and explore the SpaceX Starship. Along with just about everyone else on the ship, you are quickly finding out that they weren't just giving you the hard sell when it came to the details about how much better the ship was than past models. For one thing, you can walk around, not float. The ship has artificial gravity, which was a big stumbling block for longer missions. The lack of gravity on a months-long space mission would normally lead to significant bone loss and muscle deterioration. To counter this, the ship is designed to spin continuously, which creates a gravitational effect. You're just glad you're able to stretch your legs. Not that there's all that much room to stretch. The Starship is massive, but it's also heavily packed with supplies that you'll need for both the voyage and the establishment of a base on Mars. That means the ship doesn't quite have a roomy feel for the 100 passengers on board. You each have your living quarters, which is pretty close to a bunk or a Japanese capsule hotel. It is not roomy, but it's also not cramped. There's room to gather, but mostly in small groups, and you'll probably be spending a lot of your time in your pod. That's fine, you like your privacy. And you're also glad that this ship has taken care of a lot of other amenities. One of the first questions most astronauts ask their trainer is, what about the bathroom? In the past, astronauts had to wear diapers for part of the mission and use tubes and vacuum toilets to take care of their business in zero gravity. The SpaceX model has adapted and improved these toilets so astronauts can do both number one and number two in succession using the same device and get rid of all the waste via a simple ejection. No muss, no fuss, unless something hits a UFO in the windshield. You were a little nervous the first time you used it, but honestly, it wasn't that different from using an airplane toilet, except there wasn't a guy in a Hawaiian shirt banging on the door. And there are also a few other pleasant surprises. You remember visiting the planetarium as a kid and getting to try what they called astronaut food. It was all freeze-dried things that didn't taste bad, but they had a very strange texture. You couldn't imagine eating that for 6 months, to say nothing of the nutritional pastes in tubes that astronauts used to eat. But on Starship, it's different. The artificial gravity makes eating on board much less hazardous, as free-floating particles won't get into the sensitive machinery. So the food on board looks a lot more like, well, food. It's primarily composed of shelf-stable meals that resemble the kind that you find at the supermarket for the microwave. As you dig into your Salisbury steak with mashed potatoes, you think, it could be worse, although you are getting school cafeteria flashbacks. But you have a feeling you're gonna want something fresh, and you just might make that happen. As one of the botany experts on your mission, you're going to be responsible for establishing the first Martian garden. But you get a test run first. Your little corner of the ship involves a garden designed for maximum sun exposure. It's designed to grow some of the hardiest crops out there, which were tested on the International Space Station. If things go right, you'll soon be providing potatoes, cabbage, lettuce, mustard, and radishes to liven up the regular fare. Let's hope everyone's in the mood for veggies. You've been working pretty hard. Time for a good night's rest. Day 3, the daily grind. You stretch as you get out of your pod. Not exactly cramped, but you definitely can't toss and turn as much as you usually do. It's another day on the ship, and it's all starting to feel a little normal. You know the guy in the pod next to you, Norman, the engineering guru. You're glad to have him on board in case something springs a leak. And the food is starting to feel a little predictable, too. Breakfast will likely be something containing eggs and meat, while lunch will be a lighter chicken or a fish dish, and the dinner will be something heartier. It's pretty satisfying, which is good because there's a lot of work to do. Everyone is pretty busy on the ship with structured duties throughout the day. You spend most of the time with your botany team carefully checking the status of your garden. Things look to be coming along well, although it'll be a while before anything's ready for the dinner plate. When you're not working, you're spending much of your time in seminars that'll be relevant to everyone about the Mars mission, where there is no room for error. But it's not all work and no play. Everyone goes to sleep on their own schedule, so after hours, you're usually in your bunk watching some movies or TV. There's no regular internet service on the shuttle, but it comes preloaded with plenty of modern classics. Time for that Simpsons rewatch. But you have to admit, you're getting a little homesick. But there's good news about that. Day 7. Calling home. You might not be able to check your Facebook whenever you like, but the ship isn't without internet access. While it needs to stay in contact with NASA for important mission updates, the Starship team also knows how important it is to keep the crew in touch with Earth. The ship is equipped with a state-of-the-art laser-based internet system, similar to the one used on the International Space Station. Most of the time, it's reserved for mission-critical data and communications, but once a week, it's turned over for video chats, giving astronauts a rare chance to connect with the loved ones they left behind. And now, it's your turn. Everyone goes in shifts, not to overwhelm the delicate system. You've been happy to let everyone with spouses and kids go first. As one of the younger scientists on the flight, though, you know your mom and dad have been waiting to see you. Sure enough, mom and dad have all sorts of questions. Mom wants to know if you're eating well, dad wants to know if they can speed things up a little, and most importantly of all, they bring Mr. Whiskers to the screen so the cat can say hi. The cat seems unimpressed, so you're in space. That's no excuse not to be giving her salmon treats. And every day, you're a little bit closer to your destination. Day 20, wake-up call. A strange shrieking noise jolts you out of bed. And no, it's not Norman the Engineer's sleep paralysis episode. It's the ship's alarm. There are people rushing all around you. You stagger out of bed. Fortunately, the artificial gravity is still operating. And you rush over to the garden with the botany team. Thankfully, all seems to be well there. No one wants to be the source of the apocalyptic alarm, but that doesn't make you feel any better because something is wrong in the ship. And when you're millions of miles away from Earth, every minor error can mean the end of everything. And there is no eject button. Once everyone has secured their area, they're ordered to head to the other areas to offer assistance as needed. It's a game of trial and error, checking the systems until it's determined that the source of the error was an overheating console. It needs to be reset and given time to rest. But no critical data was lost, and no permanent damage was done. But it was a rude wake-up call for everyone, a stark reminder that no matter how advanced or secure the ship is, you're always one mistake away from turning into floating space debris. You're exhausted and you're ready for bed. That's enough for the day. Oh, right, the day is just about to start. Back to the grind. And the further you get from Earth, the more real this all starts to feel. Day 45, getting crowded. It takes time to really get to know people. You remember getting along with your college roommates, at least until you realized Mike liked to leave his dirty dishes in the sink for days, and Kevin had, well, company over every night of the week. Eventually, you learn people's quirks, and some of them annoy you. Most of your 99 roommates are okay, but there is that one guy who always chews with his mouth open during mealtime, and that guy who always laughs the loudest during the movies. Oh, and then there's Megan from Tucson. She somehow knows an unsettling amount of gossip about her social circle back home, despite having spent enough time studying to earn 3 PhDs in geology and astrophysics. Space may be vast, but there is no escaping personality clashes on a ship full of humans. You're about a quarter of the way through your journey now, and it's starting to feel like home. You've made several phone calls home. Mr. Whiskers never seems any more impressed with your presence. And you're even starting to form some connections. Greg from engineering is just as obsessed with your favorite show as you are. The two of you have already spent hours debating fan theories and speculating about how it all ends. You just hope that you'll be back on Earth before the next season premieres. But as you get closer to the Red Planet, your thoughts start to trend more and more toward what you'll be doing once you're there. And you're about to get your first taste of it. Day 60, dig in. It's been the sum of all your work so far on the ship, growing the crops that'll supplement your food on the starship. First, they were just seeds in the soil. Then they started slowly sprouting, and now there are leaves all over the garden. It's harvesting day. They all look a little smaller, maybe a little less colorful than you would see on the shelves at Whole Foods, but it's not all about the looks. There are no signs of wasting or blight, and they should be safe to pick, wash, and soon divvy up amongst the crew. Of course, the main question is, how is it gonna taste? There's a new course on the menu with today's lasagna dinner. It's a small salad of multiple greens topped with micro-planted radishes. It tastes fine. You and the rest of the botany team look around nervously as everyone takes a bite. No one seems to be enjoying it, and anxiety seems to slip in. But was your mission a failure? No, wait, no one really likes the taste of salads and hearty greens and radishes. At least not without a massive squirt of ranch dressing. They're getting the nutrients they need, and so are you. Mission accomplished. But as you get closer and closer, things get ever more perilous. Day 78, close call. It's rare to have everyone on the ship doing one thing, but today everyone's eyes are glued to the monitor. It all started when the ship couldn't get a signal from NASA that morning, indicating a problem with the communications apparatus. The further you get away from Earth, the trickier it is to keep everything operating. And not only would a communications outage ensure no one could contact home, but it could prevent critical updates from NASA, including important details on the mission plan once you land on Mars. Several hours of investigation reveal the culprit. One of the receivers on the ship's exterior sustained minor damage, likely from a space debris strike. Fortunately, it can be fixed. The bad news is, someone's gotta do the fixing. You're more of an inside kind of astronaut, thankfully. This daring mission will be left to two of the veteran spacewalkers on the crew, Adam, who has the most experience of any astronaut on the ship, and Melissa, who's one of the ship's electronic experts. They know what they're doing, but every spacewalk is incredibly dangerous. One wrong move or a direct hit from a piece of debris could leave someone stranded in space floating aimlessly. That's why the astronauts work in teams, safely tethered and are secured to the ship as they make their way toward the problem. It takes several more hours of careful welding, but eventually the red lights turn green and the astronauts make their way back toward the airlock. And as it safely shuts, everyone breathes a sigh of relief. Onward and upward. Day 90, halfway there. It's another day on the ship, but it's just not any day. You've passed the halfway point to Mars and everyone is celebrating. It's time to break out the steak dinner. Well, the ready-made steak dinner. The texture is more like pot roast, but it is definitely more satisfying than anything you've had since you've left Earth, and dinner comes with wine. Everyone's spirits seem a little bit lifted, which is a good thing because there's still a long way to go, and it's going to test everyone's spirits to make it all the way there. Day 100, inventory. You're part of a team that everyone and no one wants to be on. One of the critical parts of this mission is making sure everyone has enough supplies to get there and back. The meals were carefully parceled out to make sure everyone on board has 3 every day, so they're the least concern. But all the other supplies are far more variable. So for this part of the mission, you've been selected to do inventory and report back if anything needs to be rationed. Fortunately, all the critical supplies seem to be in order, although some of the snacks seem to be getting pretty low, especially the space donuts. Thanks a lot, Dave. As you draw ever closer, it's crunch time for prep. Day 120, training. You're much further from Earth than you are from Mars by now, and everyone's looking ahead to the next big step. You all know your general missions once you arrive on Mars, including who goes first. Veteran astronaut Adam has been granted the honor of being the first person to set foot on Mars, and everyone's pretty okay with that. After all, the guy has spent so much time in space, he's basically a native. He'll be joined by the initial exploration team, which will secure the area. From there, the electronics team will take over, because you're going to have some help to kick things off. The remote-controlled rovers on board will be doing much of the heavy lifting. They'll be the ones transporting massive supplies of metal and lumber to construct the fortress that will become the base for future Martian missions. You and your team are scheduled to be one of the later groups to disembark, only after the base is prepped and it's time to set up your first garden. And you're more than fine with that. If you're not going to be the first to step on Mars, you would rather hang back and see if anything goes haywire before heading out. With orders in hand from the mission commanders, it's time to pass them along to your team and get to work. And it's all hands on deck from here on out. Day 179, the countdown. It seems like everyone is at the window these days, not surprising. Everyone wants to see that big red dot get bigger and bigger. You're pretty sure you can make out features on the surface of what will be your new temporary home in the next 24 hours. But first, there is one more day of travel to get through and one more night, if you can sleep. There's another celebratory dinner with surf and turf and champagne. But no donuts. We're looking at you, Dave. The communications are still going strong. So NASA sends a final good luck before your mission is broadcast before billions of people the next day. There is just one obstacle in your way, the landing. Day 180, touchdown. You've had your run of the ship for the last 6 months, and you're used to it. But today, you're securely strapped into your console seat once again. Like you were on day one, the rocket thrusters engage and you make your descent to Mars. Any landing is perilous, but this will take a different type of technique than returning to Earth. While Earth's dense atmosphere poses a serious risk of the ship overheating and breaking up, Mars's atmosphere is extremely thin and mostly composed of carbon dioxide, meaning it's a clear shot down there. You move too fast and the ship could wind up in a fiery wreckage on Mars. You hold your breath to find out if you're about to make history or be history. It's a rough landing, but soon the ship safely lands and the rockets turn off. You're on the surface of the red planet, and everyone dons their full spacesuits. The airlock engages, and Adam and his initial team of astronauts prepare to disembark. Like everyone a planet away on Earth, you watch as the doors open. Adam steps down the stairs and says those fateful words once again. This is one small step for man, one giant leap for mankind. And a giant cheer emerges from the ship. You have made history. And now you've got to get to work. The next few months, which is what the mission has been budgeted for, will be filled with hard work, uncharted territory, and bold experiments. You'll be working where no one has before, and there will likely be a lot of trial and error. For you, the day isn't actually going to be much different than it usually is. You'll be staying in the ship, following your routine and planning for your time to head onto the Martian surface. For now, all the astronauts will return to the ship after a day of work. But eventually, some may be temporarily quartered on the surface. And when your time is here, you get to do it all over again. You won't be spending nearly as much time on Mars as future missions will. Your job isn't to build a full colony, it's to test the limits, see what's possible, and then lay down the infrastructure for those who come next. And when you leave, another six-month journey will await you with the same supplies. But one thing will be different when you return. You're going to be among the most famous people in the world. And the media sensation around your return will likely be the biggest thing the world has ever seen. You hope they're all really interested in hearing about your radishes. Want to know more about what life on Mars could actually be like? Check out how humanity will colonize Mars year by year, or watch how luxury crews turned into nightmare for passengers for all the details on how things went horribly wrong on a much less state-of-the-art form of transportation.